For a couple of minutes. I am the convener of the National Junior Debating Mace. My name is Catherine Duplat. Like you, when I was in school, I debated, and then I went to college and I debated some more and I ran some competitions. And now I suppose I'm somewhat of a grown-up and I'm a barrister. And what I do as well as that is I run this competition. Now, what I want to go through with you today is basically what's going to happen on the day of a competition, what you need to do, how you can prepare, how the room will be set up, all the things that are the silly questions that we don't even know are important till suddenly we don't know what to do. And then what we're going to do, if Dave does that a little bit quicker.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, so first we're going to do what happens, a bit slower now, what happens on the day of a mace. How you know where you are speaking, how the room is set up, how to prepare your speech with your partner in 20 minutes, what the difference is between first speaker and second speaker, and how to fulfil your role. Then we are going to have a mock debate, and I'm very, very happy to be able to say that we are going to have 8 highly, highly accomplished senior speakers who are going to be here today to show you how a debate would go. Now, obviously, they're going to be absolutely fantastic. They've been working very hard on this. So don't be too concerned if you think that they are fantastic. You should think they are fantastic, but they're the best of the best at senior level. So that's what you're aiming to be in a couple of years. And then David over here is going to give an adjudication of the mock debate. He's going to tell you what they did right, hopefully not what they did wrong, because they're not going to do anything wrong. And that's going to be very helpful in you knowing how you're going to be adjudicated. So, what happens on the day of the mace? You go to Belvedere, or you go to Castleknock Community College, or you go to Cluach na hIntse or St Conleth. The first thing you need to do is make sure you arrive on time. I know that sounds like a really, really simple thing, but competitions can have 150, 160 speakers speaking at them, and the person who's there has to register every single one of them. So when you arrive, you register with the organisers and make sure you have your reg fee. You'll be given your team letter. Now make sure you remember that, because I'm sure you will have more than one team from each school. So you need to remember, are you team A, team B or team C? Because that's important when it goes up on the projector as to where you're speaking. So make sure you take a note of that. Because there has, now it's not the end of the world if you mix it up, but what will happen is the ballots will go out to the adjudicators and will have the wrong names on them. And then it just causes some confusion with the tab. So make sure you remember that. Then you go to the main hall or the auditorium of the school. Make sure that you stay where the organisers can find you, because once the debate starts, they don't need to have to be going and looking for you, because there's a very short amount of time that each round turns over in. So just make sure you stay in the area that you're supposed to for the whole time. So for the Belvedere Mace, for example, it'll be this room here. And make sure you know where your teammate is at all times as well. Okay, so very basic. How do you know where you're speaking? We know that the room is set up for 4 teams in each debate. I'll be going through that in a little bit more detail. But what will happen is the first round will be announced. You'll all be sitting in here with your pens and your paper. And then it will go up on the projector what room you're in, what position you're in. And you need to make sure that you make a note of this. Because again, if there is any problem, you can come up and ask the convener of the debate. But the problem is that you only have 20 minutes to prepare. So as soon as that motion goes up, if you have to come up and ask, oh, what room am I in? What position am I in? You're just actually eating into your own preparation time. So you want to, it's only 20 minutes. So you want to get the best out of that time that you can. Okay, so as you can see here, paper and pen, very important to take a note of absolutely everything. Now, this is an example of the what will go up to tell you where you're speaking. And as you can see, what we usually call first proposition on this program is called opening government. The reason for that is because it's an English program. So we can't change that. So you need to be aware that if you are first prop, which we will always refer to you as, or second prop, then on when it goes up on the screen, it will be opening government or closing government. So that's the exact same as first prop or second prop. So if you look at this for 1 second, we see room one. We have St. Gerard's A as opening government, so that's first proposition. We have Theresians B as opening opposition, first opposition. We have St. Mary's A as closing government, second prop. And we have Loretto on the green as closing opposition. So what you need to take down is, you know, well, first of all, you need to find your school and find your letter so you can see why it's so important to remember what your letter is, because your name hasn't gone up there. In the tab system, your name's there, but up on the computer, it isn't. So you need to make sure that you take a good note of it, and then you take the room number and you take what position you are. Now, if you're a little bit confused about what the letters mean or what's opening government again, that's no problem. You can come up to one of the conveners or one of the adjudicators or myself and you can ask us and we'll be more than happy to explain it to you. So always make sure if you're not sure to go and ask somebody. Okay, so how is the room set up? You'll be speaking in classrooms like this and you will have proposition. If you are speaking, you'll have the proposition to your right. And you'll have the opposition to your left. The speaker up the top will usually just have a desk. In certain competitions, like for example in the Belvedere Mace, if you get to the final, if you're one of the top 14, then you'll have a fancy podium to speak at. But before that, you'll just have a table. And then your adjudicators will sit down the back. So before we go into a little bit more detail about roles and things like that, how do you prepare your speech with your partner? Well, the first thing is, go and find, no proposals necessary, but go and find a quiet corner to prep. So find somewhere that's near the room where you're speaking in, because all of that will be very well marked, and find somewhere that the two of you can sit away and have a chat. If you are in first proposition, you get the room. So the team that is in first proposition can go into the room they're speaking in, and they can prep there. But if you're in any other position, then you need to find an area outside the room to prep. There's no particular reason to this. It's just, it's more tradition rather than anything. Now, make sure that you prep somewhere near the room that you are speaking in. Because when time is up, your adjudicator will come to the room and call everybody for room one or call everybody for room two. And it causes a lot of hassle and a lot of difficulty if they can't find a team or a team ends up in the wrong place. So just make sure you prep in and around where you can hear the adjudicator. Okay, so when you're prepping with your teammate, what things do you need to be thinking about? Because 20 minutes seems like quite a long amount of time, but when you're under a little bit of pressure and you're trying to think of what you want to say, it can be a little bit short. So if you're in first proposition, the very first people that speak in the debate, you need to think about a model. And what a model does is it sets out what you're going to say. What do you want to happen in this debate? What is the criteria that you are setting down? So, for example, if the debate was that this house would ban smoking, as first prop, you need to decide, well, when we say ban smoking, do we mean an all-out ban? When are we going to do it by? How are we going to support people who are giving up smoking? How are we going to prevent other problems associated with it, like the black market? So what you do is you basically set up the criteria by which the debate happens. And the biggest problem if you're in first prop, if you don't do that, is that every single other team on the other side is going to get up and say, well, we don't know what they're doing. We don't know how they're going to do this. This isn't going to work. They've not told us how this is going to work. So how are you going to get the debate to work? Now, This model doesn't need to be very complicated. In fact, the simpler you can keep it, the better. Because if you try to overcomplicate it, first of all, it will take up a lot of your time, which is a waste of your own time. But secondly, the more complicated you make it, the easier it is for the other side to pick holes in it. So as simplistic a model as possible. And that's not a bad thing over the next couple of days, to just, when you're in school or when you're with your teachers, practice. Think of a couple of debates, think of a couple of motions. This house would ban uniforms, this house would ban zoos, this house would reintroduce corporal punishment. And think, what would I do in first prop if I was deciding what the model was and that was would be in that motion. So that's a good thing to practice over the next little while. Then you need to think of, what are your team points going to be? Because that's very important, because we need to know the cohesion between the team. We need to see that you're working as a team. You're not two individuals. And what we'd suggest is 1, 2, 3 points. Now, if you only have 2 points, that's not the end of the world. If you have 3 points, that's grand. If you have 1 point, that's a bit too few. And if you have more than 3, then you're not going to be able to analyse the points at all. So if you're going into 4, 5, 6 points, then essentially what you're doing is just giving us headlines. And what we'd rather you do is give us a point and develop it. So even if that means you only give us 2 points, once you develop and analyse them in a good way, that's what we're looking for. Then you need to spend a couple of minutes thinking, what will the other side say? And the reason that's a good idea is that kind of gets you to start thinking about your rebuttal. It gets to think, maybe, well, if they're going to say this, should we have a point that counteracts that? So that's quite important. If you are in first proposition, I would suggest you spend 5 or 6 minutes on your model alone. And if you aren't in first proposition, I would say nearly spend half your time on your own arguments and half your time thinking about what the other side will say. In your 20 minutes prep. So half your time on that and half your time on the other. Now, what I would suggest is something that I found very beneficial for keeping your own thoughts in order, because the structure of your speech is important. So if you get up and you just start speaking without any structure, without any points, it becomes very hard for the adjudicators to follow you. And even if what you're saying is great, if it's very difficult for us to follow, that kind of creates a problem. So what I would suggest is, if you get 3 A4 pages and you put point one and what point one is, point two and what point two is, point three and what point three is, and what your little points about those are. And then if you have that in the debate, if somebody on the other side says something that you want to deal with in rebuttal, then you literally write that on your sheet and then you're all organised to deal with that. Okay, so the proposition, as we said, are speaking here. The opposition on the opposite side. So from the judge's position, the proposition would be speaking here, and the opposition would be speaking here. And as we can see, first prop, as a team sit together, then second prop, then first up, and then second up. And this is this is when you speak. So the very first speaker in first prop speaks first. Then speaker two in first up, then speaker two in first prop, then speaker two in first up. And that is the end of the first half of the debate. So what we should be seeing in that part of the debate is the opening up of the case, is the opening up of the ideas, is the dealing with the big practicalities, those kind of issues. Then once we get to the second part of the debate, speaker 5, speaker 6, speaker 7 and speaker 8, we should be getting into the more analytical stuff. We should be getting a lot more rebuttal, a lot more direct dealing with what has happened on the other side. We should be looking at more of the principles and the analysis behind it. And the problem is, well, that can happen, is in the second half of the debate, we don't want there to just be a rehash of what's happened in the first part of the debate. So try to make yourself stand out a little, try to make yourself a little different with what you're saying and have a little bit better analysis. Speeches are 4 or 5 minutes long. Now, the reason I put that is that depends on whether you're in the preliminary rounds or in the finals, and sometimes it depends on the competition. You'll all be told that beforehand. The majority of speeches that you'll be giving this year are going to be 4-minute speeches. The only reason that that really matters is for you to know that the first minute and the last minute are what we call protected time. And this all goes into your points of information. I'll be going to that into a little bit more detail in a moment. So, During unprotected time, which is the time in the middle, you can offer points of information to speakers on the other side. And you will hear, I'll just grab the bell for a second. After 1 minute, you will hear, which means that you can offer points of information to people on the other side. And before the last minute, you will hear that again, which means that you can no longer offer points of information. And when your time is up, you will hear a double. Now, you mightn't have a bell in every room. It might be somebody clapping or it might be somebody banging a table. But it's important that you kind of don't speak for too much over your time, because adjudicators will really stop listening, because it's not really fair, because you're just getting extra time opposed to everybody else. Okay, so how to offer a point of information. You stand up, you raise your hand, and you say, on a point of information. Now, the reason it's important to stand up is for a lot of reasons. It's so that the speaker can see that you want to make a point of information. It's also so that the adjudicators can see that you want to make a point of information, because it's important for the adjudicators to see that you want to stay involved in the debate, that you don't just come up, say your speech, sit down, and that's the end of it. They want to see that you have other things to say, that you have points to make throughout the debate. If the speaker says yes, then you offer a point of information. And you need to remember that it should be no longer than 20 seconds. And if you are speaking yourself and somebody is going on and on and on, usually the adjudicator will tell them to sit down. But you are well within your rights if they've gone on for 30 or so seconds to say, I've got your point, or that's fine, or you know what I mean. Don't allow them to take up your time, because you have your 4 or 5 minutes to make your speech, and you're in control of the podium or the desk, as the case might be, for that time. So don't let people kind of barrack you and make you take points of information. You should only take one point of information during your speech and a maximum of two. Any more than that, and you couldn't possibly be able to get into your own points. If the speaker says, no thank you, very polite, then unfortunately, you have to sit down. Doesn't matter if you have the best point in the world, it doesn't matter if you really want to say what it is, you have to sit down. But what you should do is remember that you can use that point of information later on in rebuttal. You can tell it to your partner, and maybe they can stand up and maybe they'll get their point of information taken. But what you must do is make sure that you're using it as a relevant time. So you can't get up and say, remember that thing you said 2 minutes ago, I want to say this. Your point of information has to deal with something they have said right at that moment. Okay, speaker position and role. So as you've said, you've got your proposition and your opposition, your first half and your second half of the debate. So, the first speaker, as we said, what they need to do is set out the model. How will you enforce the motion, or how will you ban the motion? Then you need to say what your three main points are. Then you need to expand on them and provide analysis for them. Then the first opposition speaker gets up, who's the second speaker. They will attack the model. Any rebuttal that doesn't fit into your main points, you can deal with at the beginning of your speech. And then what you're going to do is deal with each main point plus the rebuttal. So try to weave your rebuttal into your speech, because that's very impressive, because that shows that you're able to listen to what the other side have said, but you're also able to analyse it with what you've put forward as well. Then when the second half gets up, the third speaker, what they can do is, if you haven't had a chance to go into enough depth in your third point, they can deal with that if necessary. They shouldn't be dealing with a whole point by themselves. You shouldn't really, if you can manage it, split the case between the two speakers. So with one of them taking 2 points and the second speaker taking one. The first speaker should really lay out the team's entire case. Then you deal with the rebuttal under your team points. So you say, these are the three team points we brought up, X, Y, and Z. And then you deal with what has happened under those headings. And that just gives you structure. And what you should also do is make sure that the whole time you are saying we, us. It isn't you, it isn't my speech, it isn't me, it's us, it's our team. This is our stance, because it's really important that you show us teamwork. And the thing about it is teamwork is very important. It's not going to be the thing that is going, like, if you don't say we and us, it's not going to have a terrible repercussions. But what it does do, if you've got two teams that are very close in a debate, the fact that you can see one team really worked well as a team, they had good teamwork, they had good structure, that could be the difference between taking a first or a second in a debate. And it would also add to your speaker points. So that's important to bear in mind. Then the fourth speaker in first opposition has a very similar role as the second speaker in the debate. They finish the third point if necessary, and they deal with the rebuttal under your team points. And again, make sure you refer to your partner. Now, the second team, we shouldn't be getting any new models. We shouldn't be getting any new suggestions as to how this is going to be practically enforced. However, if first proposition, for whatever reason, haven't given a model or there have been a lot of problems with their model, feel free to clear that up. And then the easiest way to do that is, well, when first proposition said blah blah about their model, well, clearly what they meant was. So even if they didn't say that, you still need to kind of give them credit for it, because you don't want the adjudicators to think that you're trying to change the debate entirely from second proposition. I would suggest that you only have 2 points in that half of the debate, because you need to deal with them entirely. If you want to have three, or you think three are good, well, then that's no problem either. You can have 3 points. But the first speaker needs to be able to deal with those points entirely, because your teammate is not going to be able to bring anything new. So you give your analysis and your rebuttal within those points. Same goes for the sixth speaker. No new model, clear up if necessary, but you do a new point analysis and rebuttal. Now, what you do need to get, and you can see it up there, is an extension. And what we mean by an extension is that you try to bring a new aspect to the debate. You take what the first half of the debate has said and you extend on it. You provide deeper analysis. You provide new points. You provide a different way of looking at the same problem. Now, these two positions, 7 and 8, who are the summation speakers in the entire debate, should not be bringing anything new to the debate. They should be able to say, these are our team points, and unless one of those has come under a lot of fire by the other side, they shouldn't be going into any more detail than that. What they deal with are the areas of clash. And what we mean by areas of clash are the areas of contention, the areas where one side has directly found conflict with the other side. So what you need to do, if you are the last speaker in the debate, is really listen to what everybody has said and find out, well, what are the big areas in this debate? What are the big problems that have existed, and why are we right and why are they wrong? So that's what you're both trying to do. Now, those are, you'll see these in better context when you see the mock debate, and when hopefully they'll be fulfilling their roles ever so well to come up. So, in first proposition, we have from Belvedere College, Rian Hayes and Connor Brown. ICYD finalists, International Competition for Young Debaters, Junior Schools finalists, Leinster Schools semi-finalist, and our convener of this year's Belvedere Mace, if you want to sit over here. And then in first opposition, we have Chris McMahon and Aisling Tully, who are last year's ICYD finalists, the winners of Junior Schools as a team. They're national finalists, and they're both ranked in the top 10 speakers in the country at junior level. Then, in second proposition from St. Conleth's College, we have Chris Costigan and Matthew Collins. Matthew Collins and Chris are Junior Schools finalists, they're Leinster Schools finalists, they're ICYD finalists, and they are all Ireland finalists at senior level. And then finally, in second opposition, we have, from Castleknock Community College, Rebecca Armstrong and A. Dawn Pilo. ICYD finalists, Aidan is All-Ireland champion, Leinster School finalist, Junior Schools winner, and we have Aidan, who speaks at the moment on the World Schools team that represents Ireland internationally and did exceptionally well last year in Turkey. Or you're going to Turkey. South Africa, sorry, he gets to travel all over the world speaking. So he was in South Africa last Christmas, last January, representing the country where they did fantastically well, and he'll be speaking on the World Skills team this year. So you are in very good company, and I'm sure you are going to see a fantastic debate.
The motion for the House is that this House would legally force internet providers to provide details of illegal downloaders, and opening the pace for Belvedere College, we have Conleth.
So, ladies and gentlemen, as you've all just heard, my name's Connor, and I'm here with my partner, Rain, today to open the case for the proposition and propose the motion. So, as Catherine has so kindly pointed out earlier, we've all spent long days and nights preparing for this, so hopefully we can give you a good show. In my speech today, I'm going to bring two main points. First, I'm going to look at what the problem we have is with illegal downloading and why it's bad, and then I'm going to look forward and say why this would be a good thing to do to try and solve that problem. But before that, I'll put forward our model here today. And our model would be that we would force internet providers to give out personal details of people who have been illegally downloading. And what details we would give out would be, you know, email address, name, phone address, and they would be given to relevant authorities only, like the Garda or something, for purposes of an investigation only into illegal downloading, so that they can be used to try and prosecute them if the Garda see fit. And we would say that this personal details would not be used further and only for investigative purposes. So that brings me on to my first point here today, is what is the point of this whole motion? Why we feel illegal downloading is wrong. The principal problem that myself and Rain have with the illegal downloading of material, be it films, music or anything like that, is that in effect it is stealing. Because what it is, when someone goes online and they download something which in normal circumstances they would have to pay for over iTunes or in a shop or anything like that, and they're taking it from free, no thanks. They are taking someone else's work, which they've used to earn their living by a song or something like that, and they're using it for their own purposes, i.e. illegally downloading it. And the problem that we have with stealing is that on a moral level, we feel it's wrong for people to go out and not afford other people mutual respect, in the sense that this is their own living, this is their livelihood. They've put their time and effort into their produce, and therefore we feel that people should respect that and not take it for their own use without the permission, i.e. the paying of it, of the person who produced it. No thanks. And so we feel that the net effect of illegal downloading is that really we have it undermining the value of the music industry, the film industry and things like that. If people, when they see a new song coming out or a new album, just say, right, you know, I'm not going to go buy it, I'm not going to go do it through normal, considered like moral ways, i.e. purchasing it, I'm going to go online, I'm going to legally download it off YouTube, wherever, and then I'll have it for myself, which is great fun. But really the problem that we have with that is, as I've mentioned before, we feel it's principally wrong to go about with that attitude, to take someone which is something which is not yours, i.e. this song, without paying for it, when we have people who use producing songs as a living to earn their livelihood. Yeah?
The justice system should defend things like having the right to own stuff. Why shouldn't they defend the right to privacy of every citizen?
Yeah, that's perfect. That's actually what kind of brings me on to my next idea here. We feel that no right is absolute in any society. We feel that in the administering of justice, i.e. trying to persecute people who have done wrong, which we feel in this case is illegal downloading, as I've mentioned before, our state, our legal system, can justify restricting the rights, in this case privacy, i.e. giving out the personal details to the relevant authorities, the Gardaí, because what we're doing is we are acting for the greater good of our society by trying to promote justice being served by cancelling out a wrongdoing, which I've mentioned is illegal downloading. And there, as a result, we feel it is okay to restrict the right to privacy of these people, because in signing up for their Wi-Fi or whatever with Aircom, it is understood that those personal details of them will not be given on to anyone else, and that because they have a right to privacy, as Adon has before mentioned. But we feel on the proposition here today that no right is absolute, and that just because someone has that understanding doesn't mean that it cannot be restricted if, in restricting it, we can act for the greater good of our society by trying to prevent a wrongdoing and trying to serve justice, which is in this case by preventing illegal downloading, because as I've talked about, it undermines people's livelihood, it undermines people's living, and we feel on a moral level it is wrong to take something which is not ours, i.e. steal it, and use it for our own personal benefit. So in my speech today, I've talked about two main ideas. First, I've looked at why illegal downloading is wrong, and then I've looked at, you know, why we feel that we can restrict the right to privacy in this case. My partner, Reem, will later go on to develop my points and further the debate. Thanks very much.
Chairperson, adjudicators, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here today with my team at Ashling to strongly oppose the motion that this House would legally force internet providers to provide details of illegal downloaders, based on three main arguments of the importance of internet security, the subversion of the presumption of innocence, and the role of the government, which I shall out for you now and which Ashling shall expand upon later. But first, I would just like to mention with regard to the proposition's model that while they say they are taking away people's rights in the hope of granting people the right to keep intellectual property, but you are taking away the rights of people who have not committed a crime yet. They have not infringed on anyone's rights simply by having the internet. They may have the potential to do so in the future, but that does not justify taking away their right to be their right to privacy. I'd like to turn now to our first point, which is the importance of internet security. The implementation of this motion requires deep packet inspection software, and such software would monitor every move of every computer, every website they visit, every email they send, and every byte they upload or download. And this all too easily casts away people's due privacy. It prevents them from carrying out any of their affairs on the internet privately without the prying eye of their network providers. And do we really want this in a world that that is so much run by and that is so much run through and by the internet? Any hope of having confidentiality in any form of correspondence or anything that is put on the internet is now jeopardised. Any important information that shouldn't be in the public eye now can be, because
Yeah, but the problem with that is whenever anyone goes online, the sites they visit and the history is saved on the modem anyway, so that information is already readily available, and it's only when they infringe upon other people's rights, i.e. by illegal downloading, that we would access it.
This requires the implementation of new software to analyse every single thing people do on the internet. And in putting in this new software, you're preventing people from doing anything without the watchful eye of their network provider. We are foolish to think the providers lack the means or wouldn't use such means to access this information. If they have to check this information to see if people are doing things they shouldn't be, then they're accessing this on a regular basis, and this information can go anywhere. And this destroys any hope of confidentiality or safety or security on the internet. I turn now to our second point, the subversion of the presumption of innocence. A cornerstone of our judicial system, ladies and gentlemen, is the principle of onus probandi e incumbit qui dicit non qui negat. The Latin for the burden of proof lies on he who asserts, not he who denies, which basically boils down to the fact that the prosecution must prove that you are guilty, and until then you are presumed to be innocent. We extend this to all aspects of the legal system. For example, if Gardaí want to search your house, they need to obtain a warrant, and in order to do so they must show that they have reason to believe that you are involved in an offence. And only if there is a good chance that you are involved in a crime, will the state condone such a breach of privacy. But by monitoring everyone, we are giving network providers a perpetual search warrant. People are all presumed to be guilty unless we can sit there watching everything they do and prove them innocent. To overturn such an allegation, you would even have to go to court and appeal and try and prove yourself innocent, destroying this important principle in our judicial system. I turn now to our third and final point, the role of the government. For years now, the government have been watching the internet expand, creating a range of problems, and the government are not acting. And the government needs to do away with turning network providers into this private police force to administer justice for them and try and police the internet themselves in a different way. Ashley should expand upon these points later, which were, again, the importance of internet security, the subversion of the presumption of innocence, and the role of the government. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I beg you to oppose.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here today to continue the case for Belvedere. My name's Rian, members of the proposition, opposition, all of you, honoured chairperson, adjudicators. Basically I'm going to continue our main proposition points and respond to some of what our opening opposition CCC have said to us. Firstly respond to the rebuttal about the model, CCC stood up and they told us that we would be forfeiting the person's right to privacy and the individual's right to privacy and going looking for this information. But ladies and gentlemen, it's very simple. The internet service provider is only passing us passing on the details to the authorities of people who have already committed crimes by illegally downloading the music. Which leads me on to our first point. Essentially, the right to have your property and not to have it stolen. Essentially, so basically, these people that produce this music, they have the right to own that privately and to sell it if they so wish. So they have it online so people can buy it and not legally download it. But by illegally downloading it, you are blatantly disregarding, firstly, that person's right to their property, and secondly, your responsibility and the onus on you as an individual to be a responsible internet user and a responsible member of society. And essentially, we on the proposition feel that by disregarding that responsibility, you're essentially forfeiting your right to privacy, and you're forfeiting your right to not have your relevant details and details of charges against you passed on to the relevant authorities. Yes.
But the problem is that the people who are being watched by internet providers haven't necessarily done anything wrong. You're presuming the innocent guilty, and that's what we have a problem with.
No, we aren't presuming the innocent guilty. I mean, it's fairly simple. Internet providers obviously have details of people's, transactions, whatever it is. There are certain websites people go onto to download, illegal music. Simple as. It's really not that difficult. We're not combing through, everyone's internet history or whatever, looking for charges against them. We wouldn't do that. Essentially, that's our first point, ladies and gentlemen. We feel that by disregarding their right to use the internet responsibly and to respect people's right to privacy, they've forfeited their right to their privacy, the individual's right to their privacy, and not having their details passed on to the authorities. Secondly, I want to develop our point about the dangerous precedent that it sets by allowing people to do this and taking a completely neutral stance, or in fact a negative stance, on it. Essentially, by not taking action on this issue, ladies and gentlemen, we feel we as a government and as a state would be setting a very dangerous precedent. No, thank you. We feel we'd be setting a very dangerous precedent in terms of we blatantly see people. We know there are people out there breaking the law, but we don't even go looking for them. We don't go making any attempt to catch them, and we don't go making any attempt to bring them to justice and to allow the authors and the musicians and the record companies to actually prosecute those individuals who have violated their rights.
If the government wants to take a stand and do something against this, why not just shut down the sites as a whole and stop it at the source?
There are whole loads of issues there, jurisdiction, whatever. We only can, prosecute people in our state, whatever else. As well as that, it's very hard to do. But we feel that this is the best way we can take a stance. If we get them with the internet service providers, it's far easier than trying to police the internet, which is essentially impossible. But we feel that it sets a very dangerous precedent, ladies and gentlemen, by not trying to take a stance on this and by not trying to do something about this and by not trying to essentially hold people to justice for actually stealing things and stealing people's property and disrespecting people's rights, essentially, and their own responsibilities. So we feel we, the state, need to make a point on this. We need to stand up and we need to say we're actually going to do something about this and we're going to put an end to people stealing and thieving other people's work. That's the case for Belvedere. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairperson, Adjudicators, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here today with my teammate Chris to strongly oppose the motion, and Chris has already presented you with our three main team points, which are the importance of internet security, the subversion of the presumption of innocence, and the role of the government. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to look further into the role of the government, because Chris only briefly touched on that point in his speech. So, ladies and gentlemen, the reason we're having this debate in the first place is because the government has sat back and watched the internet become a means for illegal activity. You know what, ladies and gentlemen? Over the 20 years that the internet has developed as a phenomenon, as something that everybody uses, the government has invested so much money in security, in airport security, in the police, but why hasn't the government invested anything in the internet? The problem we have here, ladies and gentlemen, is that the government, we are legally forcing internet providers to police the internet. And ladies and gentlemen, we don't believe it's right to have citizens to become police. It's practically like asking you to keep an eye on your suspected neighbour because he might be up to illegal activity. We don't believe it's the right thing to do. We don't believe it's moral of a government. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, we believe that this certain situation should actually be taken into the government's hands. It should become the responsibility of the government. The fact is that artists, the average citizens and even the government are all at risk from illegal downloading and hacking, etc. And, ladies and gentlemen, the problem that we see here is that internet service providers aren't licensed. So what we say is that instead of actually doing this, instead of actually having internet service providers... Instead of actually having internet service providers provide us with a list of names, instead that we would put in place safety measures, that we would actually go to internet service providers and try and make sure that internet service providers are actually taking care and protecting their customers. So, ladies and gentlemen, no, thank you. If you take us as a government, we insert safety measures for cars. I mean, we don't exactly let people go off and, you know, drive a car that's completely unsafe. No, thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, we say that we should do the same thing as a government. You know, today's first proposition has talked to you about us as a government setting a precedent. But the problem is, ladies and gentlemen, that in what the proposition are doing today is not letting the government get involved. It's actually letting the internet service providers do all the work. And we believe that's wrong. No, thank you. No, thank you. Okay, so Chris also spoke to you about the importance of internet security. So, ladies and gentlemen, the proposition has spoken to us about, you know, denying a right to protect, to catch criminals. But, ladies and gentlemen, we're not talking about the right to criminals. We believe it's perfectly right when you're punishing someone to take away their rights. However, you're actually punishing innocent people as well. You're taking away everyone's right to privacy. Yes, please.
How is when someone illegally downloads something, i.e. committing a crime, how are they completely innocent of any crime in the first place?
Oh, no, you see, that's the problem. The problem is that what we're using here to monitor people is actually deep pocket software. And we don't know who's guilty and who's innocent. At the moment, what we have is that when someone is suspected of a crime, you can go... With proper reasons, you can go to the internet service provider and you can find details of their computers, you can find details of their activity. But what the proposition are proposing today is that instead of just monitoring the people who are suspected of crimes, you monitor everyone. Thus presuming everyone guilty. And ladies and gentlemen, we have a problem with that. We have a problem with the fact that the proposition doesn't know who's committed these crimes, and yet they're taking away the rights of everyone. The fact is that it's not just combing through. The problem is that, as today's proposition has suggested, it's not combing through everyone's history. But that's exactly what it's doing, ladies and gentlemen. And we believe that this will become a huge problem in the case of, say, for example, hospitals, law firms, businesses, where things that are supposed to be kept confidential will actually be put at risk of security breaches and confidentiality breaches, ladies and gentlemen. We believe that what the proposition are proposing today is completely impractical because it actually targets the innocent as well as the guilty. And, ladies and gentlemen, we believe that's fundamentally wrong. So what are the 3 points that we've brought to you today as an opposition? Firstly, the importance of internet security. Secondly, the subversion of the presumption of innocence. And thirdly, the role of the government. Thank you for listening. I beg of you to oppose this motion.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, myself and Matthew have based this case on two of the pillars of society. Firstly, for our first point would be that of justice, and for our second one would be the importance of business to society. But before I'd like to do that, I'd like to address a contradiction that has come up from the opposition. They've been telling us that the infringement of privacy is fundamentally a bad thing, but yet they've also told us that it's the government's role to infringe on our privacy and get involved, so we don't understand exactly what they mean by that. Now, for our first point, which is that of justice. If something is involved in active criminal activity, it must be expected to have the same limits and restrictions placed upon it as anything else without hiding behind the term internet freedom. In an organised and structured society, we must have the rule of law. The law should apply to everyone. It is only just and it is only fair if the internet has the same kind of regulations placed upon it as we have in the real world. We don't see why the internet should be exempt from justice. Society simply cannot function if we allow a certain section of it to be exempt. Without justice, we do not have a civilised society. We do not have a society at all, because society is based upon justice. ISPs have an obligation, both morally and legally, to assist the state in bringing lawbreakers to justice. We've heard a lot so far about privacy and why that entitles people to fundamentally break the law if they so choose. But people aren't allowed to commit crimes if they're doing them in their own homes, for example. And the expectation of privacy does not entitle us to break the law, even if we do so privately. No, thank you. We've heard a lot about the presumption of innocence and why we are all presumed innocent. But there comes a time when you reach probable cause. There comes a time when ISPs see all of this data, which is clearly showing to them that there are people breaking the law and that they are forced and that they must act, and they already have this information. I mean, they've been saying a lot about how this is going to force the ISPs to infringe on their rights. But you must remember, when we go on the internet, the ISPs already have access to all of this information. Marketing companies already have access to this information. People know what we're looking on. Privacy on the if ISPs should be entitled to see what we're doing, why on earth shouldn't the state, if in order to keep justice in society? Now, for our second point, which is that regarding business in society. Myself and Matthew believe the current situation is undermining the ability of businesses and corporations in the music industry to operate. And we find this detrimental to society. We believe that businesses are good for society as they employ as they employ people, pay taxes and grow the economy. Go ahead.
Is the problem for businesses the one person who downloads a song or the website that gives it to millions? Why do we prosecute pimps over prostitutes and dealers over addicts but we do the reverse?
Because at the moment people feel that they aren't going to be punished if they download music. We believe most people in society are law-abiding citizens, and we believe that if we set a precedent, if we start showing that the state is serious in dealing with this problem, people will stop using it. The state should support businesses, as businesses are crucial to the development of a successful society. We have to balance out rights here. The right of a business to promote commerce and make money supersedes the right of the individual to steal music. This is because of the crucial role of business in society. Because in society, we need businesses to be profitable. We need businesses to be creating wealth and capital to enable society to grow. In a developed society, that is why businesses are crucial. And that is why it's the role of the state to ensure that businesses are supported. They should use the justice system to support businesses. We wouldn't find it acceptable if a man in the corner shop, if people went in and stole a loaf of bread from him, we would ask him to be prosecuted. People seemingly think that it's okay for corporations to be abused. Because, sure, don't they make a lot of money? It's easy to pick on corporations. But myself and Matthew believe corporations are a cornerstone to a civilized capitalist society. We believe that they benefit and advantage society to such an extent that it ensures that we can all grow and establish, that we can all have wealth, that we can all advance within society. I have brought you two ideas today, which have been why it is important that justice in a society is maintained through through prosecution of people who are illegally downloading music through ISPs, and the importance of businesses to a society. Matthew will be bringing up what he believes were the main points of clash that came up in today's debate. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, adjudicator, timekeeper. I'm here today, my teammate Aidan, to open the closing opposition. And today we're going to bring two main points to this debate. Our first point being, why scapegoating the issue of illegal downloading on our citizens is not a productive measure. Our second point being the importance of privacy. Now on to my first point. On the proposition, we feel that they have to recognise that these internet providers are a third party and a corporation, a business. And while we feel that it is their job to supply internet to the users, we do not feel that is, and we feel that it's their right to cut off the internet for bad usage, such as downloading illegally. We do not feel that they are in any position to act as an informant to a police, to take the law into their own hands and bring people to the police for simply downloading illegally. We feel that, I'm going to get into in my second point, we feel that we should be shutting down the sites as a whole. No, thank you. And why don't we feel that they're in a position to cut or to inform the police? For the exact same reason as bouncers don't send someone that tries to go to a nightclub while under the influence of drugs straight to jail. For the same reason that civilians don't send people under the influence of alcohol in the street straight to the police. They're not in the position to, and they never will be. And we feel that the proposition are missing the point here, that the actual issue isn't that someone's watching The West Wing on the internet at home on a Saturday night on their computer. It's that there's a site here allowing millions of people to do this. We feel that... yeah, go ahead.
The problem isn't that these sites exist. The problem is that there's demand for these sites. And the only way to cut that out is by putting the onus on the people who are committing the crime.
But we feel that on a practical side, shutting down each site you won't be able to shut down every site, but shutting down even one site is cutting millions of viewers of this, whether they want to or not. But by pinpointing every single person, you're only shutting people down one by one. Why don't we shut down the site and get rid of millions at a time? It's not making sense. No, thank you. And we feel, back to my point, that they are missing the issue here, that there is a higher evil here, that the evil here is the sites that are allowing them to do this. We feel that if they are going to take action into their own hands, why not shut the sites down? No, thank you. I mean, the proposition I'm talking a lot tonight about how this is going to make a huge difference. As I've said, the sites won't, and they're talking about morality and how you're stealing the rights of this. No, thank you. You're stealing from the singer, for example, their right to own their property of their song. We feel that once again, it will completely be more realistic and practical, and they need to get out of their bubble. We believe it'll be more realistic to shut down the proper problem here and shut down the sites. This leads me on to my second point, the importance of privacy. We feel that the justice system is here to put laws in place, to defend our rights and let us live freely and independently in our society. And what makes this work is the fact that everyone has equal rights, and we feel that if someone infringes upon the rights of others, they face losing theirs. We face losing ours when we're punished. But if you take action before the crime is committed, and this goes further than the cliche of you're innocent till proven guilty, it goes to the point where these people, even in their living room, going on Google, Facebook, every move they do is being monitored and tracked by these internet providers. And people are being binded to these laws that don't actually fix the problem, as you've said, because the sites are still there. They're being binded to these laws, these unfair laws, might I add, of losing their privacy, losing their security. And why should people live in a world that isn't secure? Why should they feel insecure in their own home when, as the prop have said, most of the people in our society are law-abiding citizens, and most of the people will not download illegally or do illegal activity anyway? Why is this law affecting everyone when it should be affecting the people that actually do download illegally and that are going to go on these sites? Why are we giving them a chance to? And with that, I beg you to oppose. Thank you.
Okay, so today I'm going to look at the two main areas of contention that came up in this debate. Firstly, what is the responsibility of internet providers? And secondly, how do we stop people downloading music? Okay, so moving into this first point. Because what we've heard from side opposition is that the responsibility of internet service providers is to make sure that people's lives are as private as possible. They say that when we monitor people's activity, people don't have privacy. That's particularly problematic due to the fact that when we monitor their activity, we're not given names and addresses as such. What we're given, firstly, is IP addresses. So there's no personal contact there. The man monitoring your internet in Taiwan doesn't know who you are, doesn't know that you looked up a cure for diarrhea on Google. They told us there's a reasonable expectation of privacy. Why? Why does that exist? We say the internet was formed when we didn't know that it could be used for things like stealing music. We say things that have platforms for committing crimes should have regulation. We didn't hear why this regulation shouldn't exist.
Sir?
No, thanks. Then they told us that people are going to be scared and not use the internet. We don't know why that would be true either, because people already know that internet service providers have this information already about them. And we say the people who aren't going to use the internet are the people who commit crime on the internet. We don't really have a problem with that. No, thanks. And then we heard this thing about, because we're monitoring someone, that means that we're presuming that they're guilty. Why is that true? Because we're monitoring them. There's no presumption of guilt on them. They told us that we should only do these things when we know someone is guilty. Well, how do we know that they're guilty, ladies and gentlemen, if we can't monitor their activity? They've given us this kind of completely false idea of what the world is like. Then we were told that we're forcing internet service providers to be the police. We're not. We're simply asking them to monitor the platform that they created, a platform that has potential for great harm, but also great good. I'll take closing.
They do that, and they cut people off the internet. Why is that not more effective than giving it to the police?
We say, okay, they cut people off, but we say that's they can always move internet service providers. We say when you actually mean, when it means that you can actually prosecute people, so that's far more effective because that makes it their problem. We were finally told that people would be insecure and wouldn't use the internet because they know people have this information. That information is already in existence. We say that that was completely false. No, thanks. Okay, so the second point of clash. We say they asked us, how do we stop people stealing music? They told us we can shut down sites. We say the problem with people committing crime stems from that there's demand for a service that they can get illegally. And therefore, what we do with this motion is we use the law to prosecute people. And that means that when people are afraid that their lives will be infringed upon, then they're going to stop committing crime. Secondly, because of the nature of the internet, people can always go through proxies and access these sites in another way. And sites will always appear up. Secondly, finally on this point, international law doesn't allow one country to tell another country to shut down a site. So what are we left with what the opposition gave us? Now, no company in the world has any responsibility for what happens. How can we have a functioning society that Chris told you about when people don't have responsibility, when we ask the law to be enforced by a certain group of people? We say when people don't look after each other, that means people can walk all over anyone else. And it makes everyone's lives really hard to live when people can't profit, when they can't be happy, and it's not something we're okay with. When people are commit crimes, we're told they're going to be brought to court. How will we know when they're committing crimes if we're not allowed to monitor their activity? What we've heard from the opposition simply doesn't live up to the realities of society that we've known to be true. And for these reasons, we strongly propose this motion.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rebecca talked to you about scapegoating the problem in our citizens, and she also talked to you about what we lose when we introduce this kind of crazy draconian motion. To sum up the debate, I want to look at two points of clash. First of all, I want to look at how we fix the problem that we all identify with on proposition. And second of all, I want to look at what we lose from our justice system, what our justice system should be doing, and why it fails with this motion. So the thing is that whenever we have something illegal and people provide it and people consume it, we always tackle the providers above the consumers. Why? Because we see that they're a bigger issue. Because we see every drug dealer tackles more than just one client. Every pimp hurts more than just one prostitute. And we see that this is a bigger issue when you can close down just one site instead of a couple of people. But they tell us then that that won't work. Why? Because it's demand-led. Like, first off, we'd say that in the real world that they want to link us to, that's the same issue. But more than that, we say that we tackle demand, okay? We cut people off the internet, which we think not being... Like, we withdraw the service, which we think is perfectly reasonable for another civilian to do to you, is a far effective thing to do than to just say, you might possibly get caught. Because there's this thing that it won't happen to me, the lotto effect, that people just don't believe that they'll be caught. We all download illegal stuff, and it's just not much of a deterrent. But more than that, we say that we do it fairly, okay? No thanks. Because we say that we actually deal with the people who set up the problem. We deal with the people who tried to hurt the industry, and we close down millions of sites for just one action. And they say that that's not feasible, because we can't close down actions. Like, first off, okay, we say that the internet's tough. We say that things like illegal proxies, which was their first reason, means that we can't find out your IP address and their motion won't work at all. No thanks. Second off, they tell you international law. We say there isn't a massive issue in this in international law because most countries seem to be reasonably against stealing stuff from their artists. And we think that we can probably reach consensus on this in international law. No thanks. And finally, they say, oh, but it's really hard to do. We say it's also really hard to look at every single person's IP address, to look through their history, see if they went onto these sites, see if they download this legally, and then put them in jail and try to scapegoat the issue anew. No thanks. We say that yes, it's tough, and yes, maybe we'll never crack the internet, but at least we can make meaningful steps forward dealing with the people who actually pose a threat to the industry, as opposed to trying to scapegoat people so that we can call it justice. But then they moved on, I'll take you in a second, and they said that what the most important thing here is that we focus justice, because no right is eternal and everything could be stopped just because it can. No right is absolute. We'd like to disagree, but first, yes.
But would you not disagree that we're disallowing the companies and the artists the vital right to prosecute the people who have offended them and, you know, fine them?
No, we don't. Because we believe that the people who have committed crimes against them are first off the people who have set up the industries. But second of all, what we believe is that we unpractically hurt the artists more by not dealing with this issue properly, as Rebecca told you you should. You have the massive issue of hurting everyone, which is worse than the potential harm to the artists. Why is this? It's because when you're sitting at home, you need to have a certain level of autonomy, a bit of freedom, a bit of self-assurity, to know that you're not being watched by the police in every second of your life. And when as soon as you click onto the internet, if one click on a dodgy link that your friend hilariously sent you on Facebook could get you in jail, when you don't know what you can do in your own living room, we say that's the infringement, that's the harm on people who have done nothing wrong, and that's what they have to do to catch the bad people. We say it's just not worth it. We say that catching the bad people, as they call them, won't help music industries, but it does help hurt our entire society. Because you turn you put an obligation on other citizens to essentially spy on each other. An internet provider, someone who provided you a service, like a doctor who you gave confidentiality to, has decided to tell you to the police to get you in trouble. And essentially, we say that that's a little bit creepy, and we'd prefer it if they got out of our bubble and weren't so up close and personal. For all these reasons, we beg to oppose.
Alright, my name's David Hopkins. You all automatically hate me because I'm a teacher, alright? So that's okay, we need to just get over that, alright? And I teach in Closhna Hinche, which is a new school out in Bettystown, and before that I taught in Castleknock, where these guys went to school. And people have been stuck listening to me for far too long about schools debating and stuff like that. So I'll try and keep it reasonably brief, and if you have any questions, then we'll open it back up at the end, and we'll see if you guys have any comments. Before that, I just want to talk about the standards of debate that you saw, and how you guys perhaps feel right now. In terms of demo debates, now I get college students to do demo debates all the time for me, whether I'm doing workshops in schools or I'm doing workshops at university level. The college students that I ask don't achieve this level of demo debate, because what they do is they ignore it, they ignore it, they ignore it. About 5 minutes before it starts, they go, oh crap, I need to get my pen out and write some stuff down. And they kind of just vomit a load of stuff onto the page, and then they give a really bad demo debate. These guys put in a little bit of effort and actually showed you a really, really good, complex schools level / college level debate. So on my behalf and on Catherine's behalf, I want you to show your appreciation one more time just for these guys here and thank them, all right? So having said that, I just want to try out a couple of things before you guys get terrified, all right? Chris here is one of 19 people nationally who got 12 A's in his junior certificate. That's why he threw in the Latin, all right? Aidan represents Ireland internationally in debating and has done now. This will probably be his third year. I don't think we should jinx it. He'll have trials in upcoming weeks, all right? These two girls are only in transition year and have both achieved huge things at junior level on a national level. These guys are the same as are these guys who are in the All-Ireland final of senior debating, all right? We don't expect this from you, is the point I'm making. And just to bring it right down to where Mace debating begins for you guys, and I'm sorry, I already apologize to these guys for telling these stories again. The first time I did this, Mace debating, I was in college, I was 18 years old, I stood up, I got about 30 seconds into my speech, I vomited and I sat back down. That is a true story, all right? That's an absolutely 100% true story. Saying that if you guys manage to enjoy yourself and speak for 30 seconds at your first Mace debating competition, you've done well. Don't be terrified. Come back. I want you guys to judge the debate. I want you to have a think about it for a second. You have some guidelines in front of you, and I want you to think about who came first, second, third, and fourth. And I will tell you, by the way, anyone who gets this right, good work. I will tell you that I have only 5 speaker points between, so that's out of like 200 per team, only 5 speaker points between first and last. So if you manage to figure out who came first and last in this debate, you're definitely onto a winner. So what I'm going to get you to do is, if you think first prop, these guys here, won, I want you to sit in this column here. If you think that second prop won, I want you to move over to this side of the room, the left-hand side, as you look at me. If you think that first opposition won, I want you to stay in this column. And if you think that second opposition won, I want you to bugger off over there. All right, have a think about it. Even if you don't go with your mate, that's fine. You'll find them again in a minute. All right? I'll give you 2 minutes to figure that out. All right, we'll get everyone, plonk yourselves down quick. I genuinely think only 15 of you think that those guys won and everyone else followed. I saw those look in the eyes. I saw the look of panic as you all went, oh crap, I'm going over here. I had these guys winning, but now I don't want to be unpopular. I'm already at a debating workshop. Let's call it how we see it. All right, I'm going to tell you, we'll start in last place. Now, by my scores, I actually had joint last, or third, if you want to look at it that way. In that regard, I wouldn't choose between them. If I was judging in a competition, I'd have to choose between them. But tonight I get the luxury of not having to. And joint third goes to first opposition and first proposition. All right? They literally fell into the trap that always happens in debates of they spoke first, so everything that came later sounded smarter. It happens because they gave you arguments. And these guys got to think about them and tell you why their arguments are better. I'll tell you how these guys could have fixed it in a minute. All right? Now, down two, is it the handful of you guys over there, the brave lost souls over on our left-hand side, or is it the guys who just went all the way over here? By two speaker points, you guys are right. All right, good job. Good job. I'm going to tell you quickly what I'm looking for and then how this debate went. So, huh? Yeah, you are actually sitting on each other. Go back to your original seats. Go back to your original seats. Do you know what? You were on 80 plus until about 3 minutes, and then you just started losing marks when you talked about proxy settings. You were like, here's loads of ways that you can get around our proposal. I was like, oh god, what are you doing? Stop talking. Alright, so oh, I was about to take out the teacher voice, gotta avoid that. Okay, I'm going to let you know what I'm looking for. Now, just to, you know, confuse you guys some, the two types of debating that you can do in Ireland, right? Now, there's concern in other competitions that I'm not so mad about. Your teachers might be in fair play to them. They're good competitions. But the two main competitions or formats that we're looking at are Mace, which is what you saw here, 20 minutes to prepare, four teams, and you speak straight after your teammate. And then the other one is Irish time style. I'm going to speak about that just for 1 second. Irish time style, you can speak as a team, and if you get through, you can speak as an individual. I liked that, because I used to have to pay my friend to enter competitions with me, and she didn't want to be there. So after the first round, I might get through as an individual, and then she could just take her money and go home. So the other one has individuals in it, and it suits some people. In the other competition, you get rewarded for what we call oratory, or rhetoric, which is just a fancy way of, you get rewarded for speaking good out loud. All right? You tell jokes in your speech, you have to be entertaining, you have to be engaging. Think of it as you have to aim towards Barack Obama, all right? In this type of competition, you have to aim towards civil servant desk job, right? You guys have to come up with the brilliant ideas. This has to be brilliant ideas, but if you don't speak out loud as well, you don't get as punished as you would in the other competition. So just so that you know what I'm looking for. So it's mainly content and role. Content being what's in your speech, role is in did you do your job that Catherine was outlined before, all right? You absolutely can. I'm not taking that away from you. Please do. The most important thing is that you get a personality across. I was judging a concern round last year, and someone literally just went, chairperson, adjudicators, and had left the rest of the speech down their desk. All right? It's really important to me that you get your personalities across, whether you're dry and have really witty humour, or whether you just laugh out loud, hilarious, whatever it is, try and get that across. Absolutely. At the end of the day, it's about communicating. But when it comes to content, I'm looking at your ideas and I'm looking at your involvement. All right? Your ideas and your involvement. So I'm looking at, did you have the cleverest ideas and the best arguments? And then were you able to defend them in points of information and in rebuttal? And then the other thing I'm looking for is role. So did you do all the jobs that Catherine outlined? So I'm going to do role first, just to explain to you how this debate would have been judged. All of them did role really, really well, which is good for you guys. All right? So Connor, isn't it? Connor got up first, he told you his model, he outlined his three main points, and managed to get through two of them, and then his teammate built on that with some rebuttal straight after him, and developed on the model with the third point talking about government, wasn't it? Something to do with government, it was. I know, it wasn't that long ago. He got up, he He attacked their model. He attacked how it is that they're going to do it. He outlined his team's three main points. And Ashlyn came up, backed him up on what she was going to, on what they said as a team, and managed to include some rebuttal in hers. Here's a complicated thing, all right? Because I always find the first half can be easy to do. You know exactly what you're meant to do. The second half of the debate, I always get your names mixed up. You're Chris first, isn't it?
Yeah.
Chris stood up, and he had to have what's known as an extension. Now, that's just a fancy debating word for new ideas, all right? Did he have something different to these two guys? Now, at the beginning, I thought he had an awful lot different to them. But then he started talking about whether it's morally right to steal and stuff like that, and it got a little bit similar to these guys. So the first half of his speech was marked very, very highly, and the second half, not so good. And he tried to open up a little rebuttal, all right? And we'll come back to his teammate in a second. Rebecca did something similar over here. Instead of talking about these, what did you guys call them? Deep pocket software, which is apparently how internet people can track where you live and what you're doing and all the sites that you shouldn't be looking at. They just moved away and said, to be honest, even if it's just regular IP addresses, I don't think that is the right idea. And they took a more moral stance on their half of the debate. So we had new ideas coming up later on in the debate, which is what we're looking for. And then we had a summary speech from him. In fact, he almost forgot at one stage he had a teammate and just talked about the two key areas that he was going to discuss that had come up. And then he had Aidan at the end. I think you had two key questions at the end of the debate. So in terms of role, all of them did exceptionally well. If you guys can figure out half of that, you would be doing really, really well. What it came down to then in terms of deciding who won. This debate is a really good example of showing you how everyone can agree on something and manage to have an argument about it. Everyone agreed that illegally downloading was wrong and that something needs to be done about it, didn't they? Yeah, everyone agreed it. In fact, Aidan said at the very end, he said, we agree with side proposition, which is a phrase I hate. We agreed with these guys here. We just disagree about how you want to change things. And that's really important for you guys. If you get your motions, ask yourself, is the topic of the debate going to be hugely different from both sides? Or is what this debate's really about how we deal with the problem? So for example, if the debate was invade token crappy country. Yes, I'm an English teacher, I know. All right, token poor country that has loads of human rights. You're Iraq, you're Zimbabwe, you're North Korea. All right, I guarantee you that in a good debate, all eight speakers will get up and say, turns out that crappy country, pretty crappy. All right, and everyone will agree on it. And what they'll disagree on is whether you should invade or not. So in this debate, everyone agreed that illegally downloading was wrong. What they disagreed on was how you were going to deal with it. And we really came up with two ideas. The first one was, let's tackle the individual. So when you illegally download, we're going to come and get you, all right? Not the person who gave you the information, not your parents, you. You type that in, we're going to find you, hunt you down, bang you up behind bars. That was their argument. Their argument was, well, how about we stop the people who are giving the information? How about we stop the people who run kick-ass torrents or pirate media or whatever it is? Let's get those guys and not worry about the demand end of it. Because if you get rid of them, if you manage to get rid of those guys, then the demand will go away. All right, and at the end of the day, the reason they won down the end, all right, is because I believe them. I think you're much better off tackling the supply rather than demand. And he gave you two examples which helped back him up. And I'm going to talk about using examples or analogies just really, really quickly. Can anyone remember Aidan and Rebecca brought them up first? Can anyone remember their two examples of what this is like? Yeah?
Pimp and prostitute.
Good man. And the other one? Drug dealer and addict. And the point they made, although the prostitution one has only been a change in it recently enough, but the point they made is that if you look at how we deal as a law with these two different things, drugs and prostitution, we always tackle the supply end. I think we should do the same here, all right? I bought those analogies. They were really good analogies. And when you come up with comparisons, you need to make sure that they are the same thing. Because the danger that can happen is in Rebecca's speech, that her second analogy, you had the brilliant first one, which was bouncers at a nightclub, was it? Yeah, so bouncers at a nightclub don't have to send you off to the police if you're drunk and disorderly or you're violent. They just get rid of you, all right? And her second comparison was citizens aren't expected to bring people who broke the law to the police. Well, they're not expected to, but sometimes they do. So she had a weak analogy and a good analogy. So make sure if you are making comparisons that they do perfectly match up, all right? But fundamentally, that's the reason why these guys won in the end and the guys in the end here lost. Did anyone notice any problem with Matthew's speech? The guy in the end. For 3 minutes, he was the best speaker in the debate. For 2 minutes, he lost it. Can anyone maybe think about why that might have happened? It's very technical. and probably a bit boring. He started talking about how people can get around their system. So their system was to tackle supply, as in like get rid of the websites, yeah? Their system, he argued, could be gotten around using proxy settings, which if any of you are in school and you have free Wi-Fi in school, you might know about. So how can I get on Facebook when I'm at school? I need some sort of proxyget.com. Don't worry, it doesn't work. I haven't given them any information that they didn't already know. All right? How do I get around these proxy settings? Okay? The problem with him bringing that up is that also gets around their idea. If you can get around these things and give the wrong IP address and pretend you're from somewhere else, like if, say, you want to watch the Super Bowl live, which is free in the United States, but you live in Ireland and you change your IP address so that all of a sudden you live in Kentucky, all right, which is what he said could be done, then you'd also get around their one, because how would you know where the IP address was coming from? So he pointed out a flaw in the whole case, which didn't help his side of the argument and did kind of help these guys, all right? One problem that nobody really came up with, and I'm just going to say this, again, very technical, but just in case this debate comes up, because it's going to become really, really popular, the IP address, and like all of you, or half of you, or some of you, illegally download in some way, shape, or form, and we don't condone it, all right, and it's not good practice, and you should stop doing it, you're stealing from poor artists, like Kanye West and other millionaires, all right, stop it. The problem with that no one really addressed in this debate is, what information does an IP address get you? Does anyone know? Forget about the deep pocket software stuff, all right? We don't want you guys going into our homes. I'm already terrified of you and your laughing, all right? Forget about the technical side. What IP address, yeah?
I think one part of it is like through area.
They're the first three codes, yeah?
Yeah.
You just break it down. So even if you, that's excellent, good man. So even if you just think about it, it's usually a 9-digit code. First three digits get you nation, second three digits get you region, third three digits get you home, or where the internet is being provided from, yeah? So say, for example, you live in an orphanage, all right? And they have free Wi-Fi in that orphanage. What information did you get? You managed to get the information that someone in that entire building of what could be 100 kids is illegally downloading. You haven't actually proven that any individual illegally downloaded, all right? You haven't managed to single out one individual. And what's worse, if you imagine your family, all right? So take, what's your name there, second row?
Richard,
all right? Say Richard illegally downloads, all right? And Aircon pass on his information to the Gardaí. And the Gardaí go, well, someone in that house illegally downloads, who is it? Who's likely to take the rap for that? Who's likely to get the blame?
Parents,
because they want to protect their children. So you don't actually prosecute the right person at all. Now, they might come in and take your laptop and try and find out exactly who it was, but you're basically putting families against each other. And as these guys pointed out, you're making IP servers do what is the justice system's job. And should a third party be expected to do that? All right? In terms of the debate, does anyone have any questions about, like, forget about the content, the argument. I'm sick of talking about that. I won't talk about it anymore. All right? They know why they won and they know why they lost. Is there anything about the debate, any comments that you guys have or any questions about it? In about 2 weeks' time, you're all going to be stuck doing this, so you might as well figure out or get past any of the issues you have. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Huey.
Huey. Yeah, that's an excellent question, and it's the most difficult thing you have to do in proposition, all right? So say, for example, these guys come up with a horrible model. They want Aircom to break into your home, steal your laptop, and deliver it to the police. They decide that that's the best approach to this. There is no better way of doing this, all right? And you're sitting there in the end, and you're going, oh, what am I going to have to do? I can't defend this. This is home invasion. I don't want the Aircom man anywhere near my house. They already have annoying ads. Imagine what they'd be like when they came in. So no, you don't want that happening, all right? What you have to do is try and move the debate away from the practicalities, which is how you do it, and onto the principles of why you would do it. As an adjudicator, I wouldn't blame you down the end for them being crazy. So you try and move the debate away from how you would do it and move it on to why it's important that we stop people from illegally downloading. And what happens is, if Aidan down the end here, the very last speaker, gets up and goes, well, everyone on the proposition just told us that they were going to break into your house, I would go, now hang on a second. These guys already lost the debate. You don't win anything by bullying them, all right? Did you deal with their why argument? And if you did, then maybe you've won. And if you just ignore them because it's easier to do, then I'm going to give it to these guys down the end. It's not their fault that there was a pile of crazy in front of them. Okay? Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Just a quick thing as well that wasn't addressed. just to let you guys know, not every debate needs a model. And now you're like, oh, but that was the one rule I had written down on my sheet of paper. I've got nothing going away from this. A lot of them do. The way you know is it an action motion or is it a belief motion? All right, is it an action topic or a belief topic? Action topics, like handing over internet or details from internet providers, that's an action motion. Yes, they needed a model. The motion could also be, this house believes that Facebook is bad for teenagers. Now, they're not asking you to do anything. It's a belief motion. They're not asking you to act or anything. They're asking you to support an argument that Facebook is bad. You don't need to tell us how you're going to shut down Facebook. No one asked you to. All you need to prove that it's, is that it's bad for people. So for those of you who are sitting up there, the only distinction when you're in first proposition, go in, rob the room. If someone's in the room, kick them out. Your first proposition, it's your right to be in there. All right? You sit down, ask yourself very briefly, is this an action motion or is it a belief motion? Action motion, let's get working on our model. What did Catherine say, about 5-6 minutes on a model? Give or take, spend a bit of time working on your model. If it's a belief motion, get straight into arguments. I've got three main arguments. Okay? Anyone else have any questions? Yeah. No, you don't. You absolutely don't. You're in control of your time when you're up here. If people keep harassing you with points of information, there should be a 10-second gap minimum between points of information. If there's not, and the chairperson isn't pointing it out, and a good chairperson should say, sorry, stop barracking the speaker, leave him or her alone, all right? If they're not, can you just say, you are well within your right to just say, I'll accept a point of information, but not if you keep offering them to me over and over again. I'm going to get on with my speech. So you have to be in control when you're up here. But you should allow 10, 12 seconds between points of information before you jump up. As an adjudicator, you won't automatically lose, but there's certain pet peeves, things we really hate, that will make us look at you and go, you're an evil child. And one of them is, just so that you all know, if you get up and offer a point of information, and I'm like, no, thank you, I'm moving on with your speech, and then you whisper it to your teammate, and he jumps up straight away. I'm like, I didn't accept him a second ago. I'm not going to accept you now. Nothing has changed, all right? So in terms of offering points of information, always try and create just a little gap between them and you're in control of your time. And as you saw in the debate, no one took more than two. One speaker took two and the rest of them took one. That's perfect in a 5-minute speech. All right? Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Because it's only like one team against another and there's no one but the adjudicator watching, are you talking to the other team or because you can't really be talking on the wall?
Yeah, you always get that at the beginning of speeches, you always get that awkward moment where they go, chairperson and adjudicator, who are actually the same person because you probably only have one judge in the room. So chairperson and adjudicator, members of the opposition who are actually here, ladies and chairs, empty chairs, great to see you. I'm delighted you're here. You don't need to worry too much about it. Pretend like there's an audience. In the semi-finals or final stages, depending on whether it goes straight to a semi-final or straight to a final, you will have an audience like this. And if you don't get through to the final, make sure you stay around for the final. Like, the students in my school, the ones who don't think they're very good, they tell their parents, not that it's going to finish at 7 o'clock, which is the regular time, they're like, oh, it'll finish at 5:30, because they think they're going to get knocked out, and they don't want to stay around to see the final. You learn more from watching the final than you will from just watching a regular round or being part of a regular round. You can pick up all the best tips from the guys who are in the final. But if there's no audience, don't worry about it. Also, just to say to you, if your parents, teachers, classmates, local family friend, pets, anything that's lying around, want to come in and watch you, that's fine. You are going to be limited in space, like they're classrooms, and most of the chairs and tables have been pushed to one side to create this room in the middle. But there will be 6 or 7 chairs in each room. I know myself and poor Mr. Hogan are usually jumping between 2 or 3 rooms to try and see people, so we're running out in between speeches and coming back in and stuff like that. So just parents, teachers, you're more than welcome to come in and watch and see how your students are progressing. I know that answered 6 questions rather than just yours, but did I answer yours?
Sort of.
Grant. Do you want to ask a different one again to try and cover all the bases?
Yeah, it's like, if you're talking, do you talk to the...
Oh, who do you talk to?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm an idiot, sorry. You can talk generally to the adjudicators, because they're the people you're trying to convince. And if you're talking directly about the opposition, don't get too personal. Like, we were talking about a story before about a college student who was being a dummy speaker in a school's debate, and he walked over to the speaker who'd offered him a point of information and started shouting at him to this 14-year-old like student while he was a college student, started shouting at them over and over again. Don't make it too personal. You're all going to be friends afterwards. So address it to the adjudicator. But if you are talking about them, you know, feel free to go, well, as this proposition have said, you know, And it is generally better. Don't be too personal in your rebuttal, all right? Because you probably haven't picked up their name because they might be totally new to you. And what your brain does is then just describes what they look like out loud, and that can be really, really rude. So I could be like, hi, slightly odd girl with the camera. She said earlier on, and doesn't actually, and it become very personal. The worst one always is, I remember a student who got very upset in a minute final a few years ago because somebody said, that student, or that speaker with the stupid hair. And the poor guy had gotten his hair cut for the final and he was terribly, 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 terribly upset about it. Actually a Belvedere student, one of the titlies. There you go. Very, very upset about the whole experience. Anyone else have any questions? Yes, sir. Yeah, and that's kind of what's nice about Mace debating. You get loads of experience in the one day. So you arrive at 9 in the morning on a Saturday morning. Give up your sports now. There's only 4 of them in a year. You arrive on a Saturday morning, you register. First round, second round, lunch. Are you guys doing the same way here? Grant? Yeah. First round, second round, lunch. Free lunch. Well, provided by your school who pay the reg fee, but don't worry about that. Third round, fourth round, and final, and they're all in the one day. So usually there's about an hour and a half between debates, and lunch is about 45 minutes or so. All right? The aim is to have you out of the school anywhere between 6 and 8, depending on the size. Belvedere here on the first is going to be around about, like, could nearly be 200 speakers. So by the time you get all of those results back, input them, and get another debate out, it can take a little bit more time than in other competitions. All right? Anything else? And just to say it to you, by being part of the National Mace, you're probably one of 400 or 500 speakers. It is in the top 3 non-sporting extracurricular activities in the country, this competition just, all right? And now we have Cork rounds, Munster rounds, and Connacht rounds, thanks in main to the work of Catherine, who's been convener. Like, this is only the second year of this competition, and it's already eclipsing most of the other junior debating competitions that were around. So it's great to be involved in. And for those of you who were in finals of it, you, sir? Anyone else? 9th. Sorry about that. Anyone else in the finals? It's a fantastic achievement to be there, and it's only going to get bigger as we go on. Thanks mainly to our sponsors, MOPs. That's on camera, right? Yeah, MOP. Matt Ormsby Apprentice. They don't like being called MOPs, do they? I've now said it 3 times. Okay. Cut that out. Any other questions? Yes, Huey. In the second half.
Yeah. And then they take your points off, like, should you have, like, more than 3 points set out? Like, is that...
Yeah, I mean, really, you should try and prepare. If you're in the second half debates, have 4 general ideas, and then when you hear what these guys are going to cover, you know then that you can... Oh, I'm going to get rid of those 2. They really focus on those 2. I'm going to try and develop the other 2. For an extension to work, for you to seem like you're doing your job in the second half of the debate, you really only need 1 brand new idea. Yeah. 1 totally new, different idea, and that'll be enough for you to be covered. Yeah. Yeah, but yeah, you'd want to be doing an excellent, excellent job for that, for you just to get away with that. So if you have 1 brand new idea and expand on their 2 other points, then you'd be doing well, yeah. Yes, sir. Come up with something, all right? Like, if you answer it badly, it's better than not saying anything at all. Like, there was at once, can you deal with speaker? Oh, yeah. There was a speaker at one stage who was offered a point of information, and she just said, and then there was that awkward pause for about 45 seconds, and then she just sat down. And, like, it's very disheartening, but, like, accept that at some stage you're going to get stumped. And, in fact, I can tell you right now, Chris got stumped by a point of information in his speech. Is that probably fair to say? Yeah. All right, so his whole premise was about these deep pocket software. He got a question about that in his point of information. He got stumped. He ummed and awed and hemmed and got out of it. All right, it's the same way Aidan offered quite a good one. Aidan brought up that one about, we keep talking about pimps and prostitutes, we can edit that out as well, and drug dealing. And he brought that up in a point of information, and I felt that it wasn't greatly dealt with, but always try and come up with something. All right, even if you just say, worst case scenario, you've got absolutely nothing to say, you can either just repeat the motion and go, yeah, but I think it's better if we just legally force internet providers to provide details of illegally downloaders. And the adjudicator's going, that's gold, write that down. One thing that I do try and advise people against generally is saying, I'm coming to that later on in my speech. Unless you genuinely are, I know you've just said that to get out of trouble. All right? So, for example, I think you said, that actually brings me on to my second point. That's perfect, because he was moving straight on to a second point. But if he said, oh, I'm only going to get onto that later on, then I would have been like, I don't think you are. I think you just don't have an answer to it. All right? But he did have an answer to it, so good job, Connor. All right. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, if you feel like they've provided you with a good answer, you should never settle for an answer anyway.
Yeah, like, say if you haven't said it, if they say to wait a minute, yeah.
Yeah, the only thing is that you would have made it very obvious to the judge that you had a point of information and that they managed to, like, psychically defeat it before you'd even said it. I would say try and come up with something different really quick, because what you're actually doing is going, oh, that's a good answer. I'm gonna stand and wait my chance, all right? So, but as you sound like you've probably seen the debate before, because as happens sometimes, people say, well, you just give us a second, and they continue on with their speech, which they're allowed to, yeah? And then they come back to you. Remember when they're standing up to try, and even if you just write it down quickly on a sheet of paper to make sure you remember, because sometimes what happens, they're like, okay, now I'll take that. And you're like, I can't remember what I was going to say. Oh, no, I better just repeat the motion and see what happens. All right? So, yeah, no, try and come up with something else. Don't just concede it by sitting down. Any other questions? Yeah? No, it's just first to third year. And we have seen in recent years, like, the level at which junior debating in this country is developing is actually unbelievable. Like, Aidan's probably what I'd still call the first generation of junior debaters, as in they're the first people who had junior debating. It only started about 8 years ago in this country, and it's already moving at a huge rate, that the standard is unbelievably high. But to answer your question, there's no age groups. We're seeing that first years are competing with third years comfortably enough, and that first years who might only do okay in the first year come back in the second year and third year with their experience and are actually winning. I would say the majority of people in the final last year might have been third years, but there were second years in the final. The guy from Conleth, isn't he only second year? Yeah, he's only in second year. He might look like he's in first year if any of you watch the video on YouTube, but he's in second year. Any other questions? I have one last thing to do quickly. The speaking points, yeah. Yeah. So you all have these in front of you, right? As part of our assessment for learning philosophy in the junior debating competition, teachers, you're the only ones who get that. We basically are telling you what we're looking for, okay? This is what we're looking for under the motif of Harry Potter. Yes, they're a little bit out of date. I wrote them about 3 years ago, hence why it's not something cooler than Harry Potter, but it's all I was coming up with. There were X Factor ones for a while, wasn't there? Oh, but they're old X Factor people as well. All right, I'm going to work from the bottom all the way up to the top just to give you a brief idea, and then we'll let people go home. Is that true? Roughly. Okay. We'll start with Dudley down the bottom, all right? To get a 60 to a 64, and that's really where the scale starts. In fact, if a judge comes back to me with a 58, I'm like, you're bullying a child, I'm going to send you home, okay? Below 60 doesn't exist, all right? 60, you really struggled with time. You only kind of knew what the motion was about. You probably spoke for a minute or a minute and a half, and your ideas really weren't that developed. You'd no idea what role in the debate meant, all right? If you stand up, fall over, and sit down, you'll get 60. All right, so everything above that is a plus. The difference between 64 and 65 to 69 is that basically you knew what the points were, you couldn't really explain them. So in this debate, you might have gone, illegally downloading is bad. And I think that internet providers should be forced into doing something about it. And you made points like that for about 2.5 minutes. That would get you between 65 and 69. You understood the debate, you just couldn't explain your points very, very well. 70 to 74, this is just below average. This is basically, you have all the main points that are coming up in the debate, you didn't really explain them well, you just about knew what your role in the debate is, so you're in first proposition, but you might have forgotten the model. You're in first opposition, you didn't quite do rebuttal. You're in second proposition, you knew what an extension was, but you didn't really know how to do it. But you knew generally what was going on in the debate, and you probably made your 4 minutes or your 5 minutes. 75 to 79, or the Kinder Surprise category, or Hermione Granger category, you basically understand all the fundamentals. I would expect students to get between 75 and 79 to be very close to being in the final. If you keep getting 78s and 79s, you'd be very close to getting to a final. So if you get your results back at the end of Belvedere and you find you got 64, 65s, don't worry about it. It's your first Mace. All right, it's only up from there. Okay. So 75, 79. 75 is bang on average for me. And I'll give you an example in this debate. There are some people below 75, but that's because I judge them as senior debaters, not as juniors. But for me, actually, perfect example of a 75 was the opening speech here. All right? Understood the debate, outlined a model, 3 main points. They were a little bit basic. He didn't really analyze what these guys might say, but he gave a good proposition. Bang on 75. At junior level, obviously, it doesn't look that good, but at senior level, that's what it looks like. 80 to 84, you're going to be in the final. All right? If you've managed to get 3 or 4 rounds where you have 80 to 84, it's not just that you did all the basics and understood your role, it's that your ideas were exceptionally clever. in this debate, if you were a junior and you jumped straight to the level where you said, look, we all agree that stealing is bad. Let's talk about how to deal with it. I'd be like, grand, you're an 80 pluser. You're thinking at the right level. Okay? Because what I expect from juniors, if I gave you guys this debate, what'll happen is everyone here will say, stealing music is bad. You shouldn't do it. Let's do something about it. And these guys will go, stealing music is bad. Everyone should do something about it. And no one will really talk about the difference between how you would do that. All right? So that's kind of the difference between an 80 to 84 speaker at junior level. You would know what's going to happen in the debate later on. You'd be able to analyze it quite well. 85 to 89, if any of you get any of that, we basically will pat you on the back and say, well done. You've done exceptionally well. It's very unlikely that any of you will manage to get an 85 to 89. It's exceptionally difficult to get. I would say last year's winner of the competition in the final, a guy called Sean McGuan, his speech in the final for me was about an 86, and that's what won the competition last year. You only have 20 minutes to prepare. It's very difficult for you to be achieving such high grades. 90 to 100, I'll read the line there. There's a strong possibility that this didn't really happen. You're just trying to mess with the tab. Stop it. Okay? The tab is the computer scores that Katrin keeps of all the results going back. And if you're an adjudicator who's having a bad day and you just want to mess with everyone, you might come back and just go, oh, he got a 96. Yeah. And lowest in the round is actually 41. So there you go. It was an amazing round. I think that's the best speech I've ever heard. And you're like, no, you're trying to mess with the tab. Stop it. All right? The other thing to say is, there's one thing they have to take with a pinch of salt, all right? All of you study English and your teachers, you know, it isn't an exact science. You'll know that sometimes you get a C and sometimes you just squeeze that B and there's only a mark or two between it and it's very close. Debating is kind of the same. We have exceptionally good judges only because me and Catherine are old, or Catherine and I are old, all right? So we get to call on people who are vastly experienced and we get to bully students that we once taught into doing things like this, or in her case, coached. All right. So you are lucky that this competition will be judged by people who've been to world championships and been to European championships and probably have grown up jobs and have been bullied into doing something on a Saturday by Catherine at some stage during the year. So you will get good judges and the scores will generally be very, very fair. Don't argue back with the judges too much. Question them. Ask them why you went down or why you went up. You won't get your score, by the way, sorry. That'll only come at the very, very end of the day or even the day after, and your teachers will be responsible for giving you that information if they want to. But ask the teachers for feedback. Don't get angry with them, all right? Everyone involved in this competition, in particular, I say it of Catherine, like, everyone involved does it voluntarily, all right? They will give all of their advice to you. They don't need to take you guys getting really upset and angry at them, all right? They're doing it voluntarily. But the 90 to 100 thing, if any of you manage to get it, I will probably ask my principal, can I get you a scholarship to come to my school? And then I'll just coach you to be on the World Skills team. So it'll be an amazing speech that managed to get that. Does anyone have any questions about speaker points? Yeah?
Every time you're talking and then your speech doesn't last like 4 minutes, does the audience get to like speak
in your time? Get to speak?
In your time.
No. Not unless you accepted them for a point of information. If you only speak for 2 minutes and you're happy that's the end of your speech, you'll sit down. And that'll be the end of it. And they don't get any extra time because of that. Okay. All right. And if you speak overtime, what I do is I don't punish you. Like in concern in other debating competitions, you lose marks every time you go overtime. What I do is I just put down my pen and I stop listening. So if you're speaking at 5:15 or 4:15, depending on how long speeches are, 4:20, I just stop listening. So you're not going to get any extra points. Why should you get more time than anyone else? All right. Anything else? Catherine?
Just before I let you go, I'll just a big round of applause to everybody and David for his adjudication. So, a big round of applause.
Good job.
Before we let you go, and it's just something very, very simple, I just want to explain to you this in the context of the greater, I suppose, national competition and how you can qualify to speak at nationals. So, as you know, there's four Maces. There's Belvedere, which is on the 6th of October. There's Castleknock Community College, which is on the 24th of November. There's St. Conleth's College, which is on the 19th of January. And there's Colossian Hincha, which is on the 2nd of February. If you would like to be in a position to qualify for the national competition, you need to have spoken in a minimum of two of those debates. If you speak in more than two, that's no problem at all, but you have to have spoken in two. What I do then is I take the speaker points, only the speaker points, not your team points, and I average them. So your two highest speaker points overall from two individual competitions are averaged out. They're all computed. And basically, we ask the top 80 speakers in the country to come and compete at National Finals Day, where you compete as an individual. When you compete as an individual, you still speak in teams, but you are randomly paired. And because you only need 20 minutes to prepare, it doesn't matter that you may not have met this person before. So, for example, it could be as simple as Chris is speaking with Aidan and Rebecca is speaking with Connor, and they might have never spoken with them before. It's all done entirely randomly. So we get the top, last year we had the top 40 speakers compete out of over 400 speakers that had competed in competitions in Leinster, Connacht and Munster. And out of those top 40 speakers, only eight people qualify for the grand final. And the grand final this year will be held on the 9th of March. And if you win the grand final, you get a very, very, very beautiful perpetual trophy and you get some awesome prizes. I think last year, Sean got a laptop, so that's kind of cool. So what you need to make do if you do want to qualify for nationals is make sure that you have discussed with your teacher that you're in a position to do at least two of the debates. The one thing that that's also good at is if you do want to speak with different people in different debates and maybe people are at different levels, that doesn't matter because all that matters for nationals is your actual average of speaker points. So I would ask you all to, if you can at all, be in a position to do a minimum of two debates to put yourselves into the possible ranks of nationals. And other than that, regardless of how you do in Belvedere or Castleknock or any of the other Maces, do keep coming back, because the one thing that I've seen from looking at the tabs, which I would have never looked at any other year from debate to debate, is people who are getting in maybe the bottom 10 or 20 out of 160 speakers in Belvedere were in the top 10 at a Mace in February. So the only way you're going to get better at this is to speak and do as many speeches as possible and speak in public as much as possible. So I want to wish you all the best of luck. I want to thank everybody for coming today. And if you have any questions that you want to ask, make sure you tell them to your teacher.